Good morning and welcome to Layton Avenue Baptist Church. We're so glad you could join us in-house and online. If you are a first-time guest, we are so glad that you decided to join us for service, and we pray God's blessings on you throughout this service. Got just a few announcements. As we all know, we've been doing the Annie Armstrong offering, and so our goal again this year was $3,500, and it looks like we're at about $1,916. So we're doing well, but I ask you to continue to be in prayer about this. If you have not given yet, go to God. He will direct you where you need to go with that. Following the morning worship service today, we have our business meeting. That'll be about 12:15-ish, somewhere in that area. So hope to see you all there for that. Our Souls for Jesus, we have a black and white bin in the lobby. It says Changing Lives, 2x2. So if you're interested in giving to this, you can go ahead and put them in that black and white bin. And if you have any questions, you can see Ms. Barb Condellin for this. Builders for Christ, as everybody knows, is May 17th through 23rd. So if you are still interested in this, you can see Ms. Paula or Ms. Kathy. Next Saturday, April 13th, we're having our spring extravaganza. Ms. Sheila?
Yes, next Saturday is our big event, community outreach event with our kids and other kids. I just want to remind you of that. I also want to remind you that this is the sign-up sheet. We are in need of people to help set up and to tear down. This is a two-hour event, 2 hours. So it's not like you're out of pocket for the whole day or something. So please consider helping us. It would be greatly appreciated. And then let's see, we have little flyers out in the lobby. Grab a few, hand them out. And let's make Saturday a bigger event than it was last year. It was pretty big last year. So let's pound the ground with this and just come out and enjoy the smiles on the kids' faces. It's just nothing like it. All right, thank you.
Thank you. Let's see what else. April 20th, we have our Builders for Christ Italian Dinner Fundraiser. And anybody who's other than me, because I forgot my tickets at home, but any Builders for Christ member, you can go to them. We're selling the tickets. They are $10 each. And I think kids 5 and under are free. But anyway, there's some flyers, or there's a flyer out in the lobby for that. But you can see any of us that are on the Builders for Christ team. We have tickets, and that's next. That's April 20th. Again, $10 per ticket. And does it start at 5:30 or 6? 5. Okay. The other thing that's very, very exciting, well, more for me than everybody else, I'm sure, but we have our first work day coming up April 27th at 8 a.m. till noon. There is a sign-up sheet in the lobby. We've got a lot of things listed on there. We're hoping to get a lot of them done. You will see in your little tear-off, there's a little bit of a list here, but there are a lot of things that we're going to be doing. So I'm looking forward to seeing who's coming out for that. Operation Christmas Child is still going on. There's a bin out there in the lobby for that as well, or in the fellowship hall. So they're still collecting washcloths and soap, mild soap. Again, if you have any questions about that, see Barb. I did want to give a shout out to the men, the Burmese church on Sunday, Easter Sunday night. We had the Burmese church come in while they were here for dinner, and we took all the pews out of here because we had the carpet shampooed and all the pews were shampooed and cleaned. And then Tuesday night, we had a group of Burmese and Spanish group and the Layton people here, and we put them all back in about an hour, lined them up. Andreas came with his measuring sticks and things and his laser. So I just want to say thank you to all of you who came out to help. And them are the announcements I have. We also have this connection card that's going to be in your bulletin. We ask that everybody fills one of these out and puts it in the offering plate when the offering goes around. And on the back, you'll see different things that you can check mark if you're interested in information about the church, if you need a prayer request, If you'd like a call from a pastor or a deacon, you can go ahead and put that on here. But let's make sure that we all put that in the offering plate. If you are glad to be in the house of the Lord today, say amen.
Amen.
Let's stand up and tell them you're glad to see him.
Oh, glorious victory.
together in prayer. Father God, we thank you so much that we can welcome you to this place. Lord, we welcome your presence. Where two or more are gathered, you are dwelling among us. Lord, we thank you so much that you walk beside us every minute, every hour, every day. Lord, thank you that we can get through times where we just don't know what we're going to do because we have you. Lord, we have your hope. We have your security and we have your love. Lord, I just pray that during this time, Father, that we will just present ourselves to you. Lord, you will touch our hearts, touch our minds. Father, that we will walk out of this building changed and changed to be more like you. Lord, we love you. We thank you so much. There's no amount of gratitude that we can possibly speak for the love that you have shown to us on the cross. Lord, we are just wanting to be here, Lord, to lift you up and to praise your holy name. Father, you are holy forever, and we thank you for all that you've done for us. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
That's right, Daniel. Amen. Out of the mouths of babes. I love it. I love it. This next song we're going to do, in Revelation it says, day and night they never stop saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Whenever the living creatures give glory, honor, and thanks to him who sits on the throne and who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They lay their crowns before their throne and say, you are worthy, O Lord our God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. This is what we're going to be doing in heaven. We are going to lay our crowns in front of Jesus' feet and singing, holy, holy, holy forever. What a picture. And I cannot wait for that day. I don't know about you, but I am so excited to be able to do that, to worship here on earth, but what it's going to be like in heaven. Oh man, what a picture. Let's join together.
All the way.
say a prayer for this morning's offering. Father, we do rejoice that you are our sufficiency in all things, and we rejoice that you have given us your Son, Jesus, to be a substitute for us, that we have all sufficiency in him, and that we are not lacking anything. Your word tells us that we are not lacking anything. So we just pray that you would help us to be generous as we think about the sufficiency we have in Christ spiritually and how you do and have blessed physically. And so we pray that you would give us generous hearts and you would use these funds efficiently and leverage them for your kingdom and for your name's sake and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Great to see each and every one of you. This is the day that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we do pray that you would just guide our time here, that you would bless the children as they go forth and do what they do. We pray that you would light up our souls today, any darkness that's in us, that you would light it up so that we can be more like you. We pray that you would guide us and teach us in your word and change us so that we can shine your light everywhere. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I was thinking about something. This is just a little encouragement before the message, but I was thinking about how Judah is starting to say, "What is this?" And he'll just turn. He doesn't even know what's there. And he'll just point at something and say, "What is this?" And it reminds me of my mom telling me when I was a kid that I would do that, although I would say, "What is that?" So I do it a little different. But she said I was relentless, just, "What is that? What is that? What is that?" all the time. And wanting explanations and wanting to know, and this inquisitive nature. And I'm thinking about that. And I'm thinking about, you know, that really is essential for growth. It really is. As Christians, we should continue in that, that inquisitive mindset, because that is how you grow. That's how you grow in a lot of things. I think of a story I heard recently. It's about basketball, so, you know, forgive me. But Kobe Bryant, who was considered the best basketball player in the world at the time, invited this young college kid to come shoot with him. And they're shooting for a couple hours, just putting up shots. And Kobe's, you know, the college player just thought he was being nice, like inviting him to come shoot with him. But that's not what Kobe was doing. He was studying this college player, because this college player was a really good shooter. And so he is studying him and watching how he shot and watching his form and his dynamics. So just in case he could pick up on something. I mean, even if it was just the littlest thing, he wanted to pick up on it. He wanted to incorporate it into his game. And you see, even somebody who's at the top of their game, Kobe Bryant, considered the best player in the world at the time, he was still looking on ways to improve. And so you, Christian, no matter how much you know about this book, there's still more you can know. No matter how deep you've gone with the Lord, it goes deeper. And we need to keep that inquisitive nature. So let's keep that mindset as we go into the Word today. Growing up, my dad had me regularly holding the flashlight for him. Many of you have experienced that time in your life. Where you're holding the flashlight for Dad. I still do that. And so his eyesight is not impeccable, so he really needs the light on the subject. It's also very helpful to be able to see what you're working on when you're working on it, right? And I've started to experience this as I've gotten older. You know, my eyes aren't as great as they were, and I do need more light than most people, certainly more than my wife, to be able to see what I'm doing when I'm working on it. Light allows me to see the reality of what is actually there. That's what light does. You get to see what is actually there. And you can address the situation because you can see what is there. Now think about that spiritually. Being able to address the situation because you have light. Light has amazing qualities. And we have a list from what's called Thinker's Bible Studies. Okay, so as we go through this list of qualities about light, which you may agree with all of them or you may disagree with some, but as we go through them, I want you to think about light physically and spiritually. And so I'll give you a second between each of the concepts to kind of think about it physically and spiritually. Light is quite unique. Light dispels darkness. Light itself cannot be seen, but reveals everything in its presence. Light cannot be grasped or held. Light fills all space available to it, but will not invade the space closed to it. Light can be everywhere at once. Light is never consumed or exhausted by anything in its presence. Light is illumination, enabling us to find our way. Light is communication by written words and symbols to our mind. Light is color, revealing incredible beauty around us. Light is warmth, giving comfort. Light is energy, producing power. Light is speed. It's from here to there in an instant. Light is essential for growth and healing. And light fades the further we move from its source. So those are descriptions of light. Maybe not adequate to completely describe light, but that is an attempt from the Thinker's Bible Studies. And I would say light is cleansing as well. I think of There used to be a show I watched many years ago called Dual Survival, and it had two guys, and one guy was, they had very different approaches. One guy was like this military guy, and he wanted to catch food and eat it and hunt and get protein, and he wanted to get out of there as soon as possible. And then this other guy was more like, let's hang out for a little while, you know, kind of thing. He was more comfortable being in that environment. And so they had these different approaches. But when they would get together, they were both experts. And what they would do is they would address situations where people got themselves into some kind of bad situation in nature. Maybe their snowmobile broke down, maybe whatever happened, and they were in some kind of bad situation, and they would remake these situations and then show people how they could get out and with the survival skills that they had. And so one of the things that they would do is when they would find water, right? So you go up to a high peak, you look down, you try to get a scope of the land, and you try to find water, because if you find water, usually there's people. And so you try to find water, and water is easier to travel along as well. But when they would get to the water, whether it was, if it was non-moving water, of course it was more dangerous with bacteria, and if it was moving water, it was a lot better. But one of the things they would do with the water is they would only drink from the very top of the water, because of the cleansing effect that the sun had on the water and cleansing out the bacteria. They would drink just from the very top layer of the water and not from the stuff that's deeper. So I would say light is cleansing as well. And in today's scripture, we're going to be talking about how Jesus boldly and clearly points to himself and he says, I am the light of the world. If you will, open with me to John chapter 8. So if we're looking at the New Testament, that's Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. John chapter 8. If you follow along with me, you'll probably get more out of it as you see the words of God in black and white. And we're going to be reading verses 12 through 30. 12 through 30. John chapter 8, Gospel of John, verses 12 through 30. Again, Jesus spoke to them saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So the Pharisees said to him, you are bearing witness about yourself. Your testimony is not true. Jesus answered, even if I do bear witness about myself, my testimony is true. For I know where I came from and where I'm going, but you do not know where I come from or where I'm going. You judge according to the flesh. I judge no one. Yet, even if I do judge, my judgment is true, for it is not I alone who judge, but I and the Father who sent me. In your law, it is written that the testimony of two people is true. I am the one who bears witness about myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness about me. They said to him, therefore, where is your Father? Jesus answered, you know neither me nor my Father. If you knew me, you would know my Father also. These words he spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple, but no one arrested him because his hour had not yet come. So he said to them again, I am going away, and you will seek me, and you will die in your sin. Where I am going, you cannot come. So the Jews said, will he kill himself, since he says, where I am going, you cannot come? He said to them, you are from below, I am from above. You are of this world, I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. So they said to him, who are you? Jesus said to them, just what I've been telling you from the beginning. I have much to say about you and much to judge, But he who sent me is true, and I declare to the world that I have heard from him. They did not understand that he was speaking to them about the Father. So Jesus said to them, "When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he. That I do nothing on my own authority, but speak just as the Father taught me. And he who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do the things that are pleasing to him." As he was saying these things, many believed in him. God always blesses those who read, heed, and joyfully obey his precious holy word. Main point number one, I am the light of the world. I am the light of the world. Verse 12, again, Jesus spoke to them saying, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And I ask you, how could Jesus get more bold than that? More bold than to say, "I am the light of the world." He is pointing to himself because it's necessary for him to point to himself. We need him. They needed him. Everybody needs him. Amen. This is a direct messianic claim. It has a dual meaning when he says "I am." It's just the normal "I am," but also the "I am" from Exodus 3:14 when God said, "I am that I am." That's his name. That's who you can say sent in Exodus 3:14. And so God called himself, "I am that I am." And Jesus is using that phrase, "I am." But also, you have the fulfillment of prophecy. As we look at prophecies about the Messiah, speaking of the light of salvation and of God. And we can cross-reference Psalm 27:1. Isaiah 9, verse 2, Isaiah 42, 6, and 49, 6. And out of those four, I would say Isaiah 9, 6 is probably, or 9, 2 is probably the most famous. It's a famous Christmas verse. When you hear it, you'll recognize it likely. "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone." Jesus was fulfilling scripture, fulfilling prophecy about himself when he's declaring himself to be the light of the world. Now, I also want you to notice in verse 12, he says, "Whoever follows me," and then he goes on and then he says, "will have the light of life." Whoever follows me will have the light of life. Notice the association there, the light of life. There's an association between light and life. Verse 13 and 19. "So the Pharisee said to him, 'You are bearing witness about yourself. Your testimony is not true.' Jesus answered, 'Even if I do bear witness about myself, my testimony is true, for I know where I came from and where I am going. But you do not know where I come from or where I am going. You judge according to the flesh. I judge no one. Yet even if I do judge, my judgment is true, for it is not I alone who judge, but I and the Father who sent me. In your law, it is written that the testimony of two people is true. I am the one who bears witness about myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness about me.' They said to him, 'Therefore, where is your Father?' Jesus answered, 'You know neither me nor my Father. If you knew me, you would know my Father also.'" So we see this deliberation happening between the Jews, between the Pharisees and Jesus. And they're accusing him of bearing witness about himself because the law would require two or three witnesses to substantiate a subject. And so Jesus retorts, yes, it is true that he's bearing witness about himself, but he also has the Father bearing witness about him. So even though the law required that two or three witnesses be there to establish a matter, Deuteronomy 17:6, 2 Corinthians 13:1 can be a cross-reference for that. This is not required for Jesus, for one thing, because Jesus is God. So there's certain things about Jesus, certain things that he's even referencing, like his origin, right? Well, what man, what witness that's a man or a woman could witness and could say, I was there, I saw that, when we're talking about Jesus' origins, his divine heavenly origins, or the fact that he is the creator, that he made all things. There's nobody that can do that except for God himself, right? So part of this is not even applicable. But in another sense, when Jesus is speaking and he's bearing witness about himself and the Father's bearing witness about him, he's exceeding the law, because the law is requiring two witnesses. Jesus himself is a witness, the Father is a witness, and those are two divine witnesses compared to just two witnesses. Verse 15. He says, I judge no one. We've talked about how there's different types of judging. We're not going to get into that now, but I will say that Jesus' main ministry in his first coming was not to be judge of the world. It was to be savior of the world. When he comes back a second time, he's going to judge the world. Here's a verse that illustrates that. John 3:17-18. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. The second time Jesus comes to judge. Verse 19, if you knew me, you would know my Father also. This communicates the truth that we've already talked about as we've gone through the Gospel of John, which is that rejecting Christ is rejecting the Father. Christ has come in a perfect obedience to the Father's wishes, the Father's words, the plans, everything that the Father wanted. And this is the Father's plan, Jesus. And so you reject Christ, you reject the Father also. You don't get to go to heaven without it receiving Christ. Verse 20. These words he spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple. No one arrested him because his hour had not yet come. And we've talked about that already as well, which is Jesus cannot be touched until the appointed time from the Father, until God the Father allows it to happen. And he will, obviously. We know what happened. It was all part of the plan. But for now, he still has time. In the divine plan, he still has time to teach and to speak and to proclaim the truth. Main point number two, I am going away. Verse 21, so he said to them again, I am going away, and you will seek me, and you will die in your sin. Where I am going, you cannot come. So when Jesus said that they will die in their sin, he's saying that because they are rejecting him. And he further clarifies that a few verses down we will see in verse 24. He clarifies that. He tells them what is going to happen, that he is going away. Now he's not plainly telling them what is going to happen. He tells them in a way where they don't quite understand. They don't quite understand because they're not supposed to understand. Isn't that interesting? Sometimes, when our heart is not right, God is not going to allow us to understand some things. Why should he show you more of his amazingly deep divine truth when we are rejecting or not walking in the amazingly deep divine truth that we have? Not to say that anybody does it perfectly, but as a general principle, it does make sense. Which, that scriptural principle is also brought out in throwing your pearls before swine. They will These people who are rejecting Jesus, they will remain in darkness. They will continue in their deeds of darkness. And what is that going to do? That's going to set up an environment. These are the authorities, the Pharisees. They're operating in darkness, and it's going to set up an environment of darkness. And guess what's going to happen? Jesus' light is going to shine even brighter in that kind of environment when the time comes. He's going to shine on the whole world. Verse 22. So the Jews said, will he kill himself since he says, where I'm going, you cannot come? So the Jews, the Pharisees, they're not responding to Jesus' message about you will die in your sin. They don't seem to be worried about that. They are concerned about where Jesus is going because they have plans for him. But they're not too concerned about him saying you will die in your sins. The thing that they should be concerned about, they're not. There's a spiritual blindness that the world has, that those who don't know Christ have, and they don't see how important things, the thing of knowing Christ is. And so they're concerned about things that are less important. And they want to know where he's going. And then there's also this theme that just keeps coming up in the Gospel of John. And that theme is people misunderstanding Jesus. We've talked about many times through the Gospel of John already. We're in chapter 8. We're planning on going all the way through 21, through the whole book. But already there's been several instances where people have misunderstood Jesus. He's speaking spiritually. They think he's speaking physically. And here we have another misunderstanding. They're kind of on the right track. They said, will he kill himself? Well, he is going to die, but he's not going to kill himself. But again, a misunderstanding. They're guessing at what he means. They're not quite getting it right. He said to them, you are from below, I am from above, in verse 23. You are of this world, I am not of this world. Jesus is speaking of his divine origins. I am not of this world. I am from above, he says. Now, this contrast, and here we have another theme of the Gospel of John. And themes are wonderful things. We pick up on these themes. They run through the Gospel of John, and they are things that God wants to emphasize through John the writer. This is an emphasis, which is we have contrasts. We have light and darkness. We have life and death. We have several other contrasts in Scripture, in the Gospel of John. And if we can pick up on those contrasts, here we have a contrast between heavenly origin and earthly origin. And Jesus is using that contrast to explain his heavenly origin. You are from below, I am from above. Main point number 3, I am he. I am he. Verse 24, I told you, this is where the clarification comes in, about dying in your sins. I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. So when he is saying, I am he is saying, I am the Messiah. I am the Savior of the world. Verse 25. So they said to him, who are you? Jesus said to them, just what I've been telling you from the beginning. Just what I've been telling you from the beginning. Again, Jesus does not exactly directly address their question. He doesn't make it plain for them. He doesn't put the cookies on the shelf, as they say. Jesus dismisses their question because he's already stated his messianic claims. He said, I am the light of the world. I am he. He's already said those two things. Then they ask, who are you? He dismisses it. Verse 26 to 27 dismisses it except to say, I've already told you from the beginning. 26 and 27, again, we have that theme of not understanding. Listen to this. I have much to say about you and much to judge, but he who sent me is true, and I declare to the world what I have heard from him. They did not understand that he was speaking to them about the Father. So he's using that word him. They're like, who are you talking about? They don't know. Verse 28. So Jesus said to them, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing on my own authority, but speak just as the Father taught me. Again, he's purposefully not giving them all the details. But he says, when you see the Son of Man lifted up, then you will know. Then you will know. So that begs the question, what are they going to see when they see the Son of Man lifted up? What does lifted up mean? It means lifted up on the cross. And then, what are they going to see when they see the Son of Man, which is a messianic term, right? Pointing to himself as the Messiah, the Son of Man. What are they going to see? Well, they're going to see an earthquake happen. At the very time that Jesus is being crucified, they're going to see darkness around them like they've never seen before. A thick darkness in the air. They're going to see the veil torn in two to the Holy of Holies from top to bottom without human intervention. And they're going to see people rising from their graves. Then they will know that, quote, I am he, end quote. Verse 29 and 30. And he who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do the things that are pleasing to him. As he was saying these things, many believed in him. Jesus is claiming to be without sin here. He said, I always do the things that are pleasing to the Father. Always. What is pleasing to the Father? Living holy, righteously, not sinning. So in a sense, he's claiming to be without sin. He's always doing the things that please the Father. This is another huge messianic claim. And it's not just a claim, it's the truth, right? And there was wonderful results. It said many believed in him. May it be. May it be among us that we believe enough to take the next step with him. Whatever that is for you. Whatever that is for me. What's the next step? In Christ. Conclusion. Jesus is our light in a dark world. He illuminates our hearts through the Holy Spirit and enables us to love what is good, right, pure, and holy. He illuminates our minds and provides us power to think on and focus on the things that actually, biblically, eternally matter in life. And he also illuminates our way. He shows us where we have departed from his design and his perfect path for us, where we have departed. He shows us, and then he shows us the way that we should go. He illuminates our path, our divine path from him. He gives us spiritual giftings that align with our calling in this life. We all have a spiritual calling in a sense. We have a role to play in the body of Christ, in the kingdom of God, a role that builds others up, the people next to you, the people across the aisle, the people across the street, builds them up. And that role that God has for you has been preordained by him. Preordained by God himself. We see that illustrated in Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. So Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 talk about salvation. By grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Salvation is a gift. Talks about being saved. And then in verse 10, for. What is that salvation for? For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. He has a path of good works that you are empowered, a path just for you. And he illuminates that path with his light. He empowers you to walk in that path through spiritual giftings and spiritual power and desires for what is good, right, pure, and holy. He gives you the ability to focus. And he illuminates this path for you. Doesn't mean that you never slip or stumble. He catches you when you slip and stumble. But he does have this wonderful path prepared for you. It's like a perfect obstacle course just for you, for your own growth, but also that benefits other people. And glorifies him. So not only does Jesus light up our heart and our mind and our way, but he also lights up the world around us through us. Amen. You are a vessel. We don't have the light in ourselves when our friends or our family or whoever it may be, when they're in a dark place, we don't have the light in and of ourselves to give them. It's Jesus shining in and through us. And he can do that. He can speak through you. He can work through you. Maybe your family member needs this or that. Or maybe their real need is over here, even though they think they need this. But they have a divine path too. And you can help and you can bless with light for that path because Jesus is living inside of you. We are vessels. And so as we think about this concept of being vessels, we think we can shine Jesus' light clearer and brighter when we are clean. Right? If you have a dirty, dirty vessel, it's not going to shine as bright. But if you have a clean, perfectly clean vessel, it's going to shine. So we need to confess and we need to forsake the darkness of our sin. The darkness of our sin, which of course has a dimming effect on our light shining. So we need to do that, but there's also something else that we can do to shine bright. And it goes back to what we talked about at the beginning when we talked about the Thinker's Bible study. We went through that list. And it is being close to the source of the light. The power of the light. Jesus is claiming to be the light, right? And so Jesus himself is just clothed in power. And the power of that light, the power of Jesus, the closer we get to him, the brighter the light is going to shine. So, yes, that has to do with cleansing. But it also has to do with seeking. Remember what I was talking about when I was talking about Judah? Saying, what is this? What is this? He just points at something. He doesn't even know what he's going to point at. But he wants to know. That inquisitive nature. We need to be inquisitive about the things of God. Thinking about how deep we can go with God. Like some of these concepts, yeah, I've learned about that. Yeah, I've heard something about that. Do I know that well enough to teach my coworker, to tell my coworker about it, to tell my family member about it? You know, that might be a goal. Going deeper in whatever it is. So some of you are musicians, going deeper in the things of music for the Lord and for His glory. Going deeper, some of you might be artists, going deeper in your art for God's glory. Whatever it is, in your business, going deeper in the things of God. So let's say you have a business. What business principles can I find in God's word? What things can I apply to my business from God's word? Maybe my parenting, maybe my relationship with my spouse. Going deeper in all areas, in whatever areas you're gifted in. Whatever areas God's calling you to, go deeper with Him. Find out more about His word. There's so many resources out there now. And we have the greatest resource. We have the Bible, God's word in our hands. The Thinker's Bible Study said that light fades the further it or we are from the source. Light fades the further we are from the source, right? So if you think about a little flashlight that maybe of average strength, you look at it and you're right next to it, you can see it very brightly. You go 100 feet away, it doesn't look as bright. You go a mile away, you probably can't see it. But this also means that light intensifies the closer we are to it. And so, cleansing and drawing close to Jesus. Let's shine brighter as vessels of Him. Cleansed vessels. Cleansed vessels that are drawing closer, that are inquisitive, that want to learn, that have a learner's spirit. We go through life and we learn so much and we think we know. We think we know. Things that we don't know. You know, you learn a lot about cars, and eventually you learn so much about cars that you think you know, but they keep coming up with new stuff to learn. Computers, whatever it is, all that pales in comparison to the things of God. Because through eternity, we get to go deeper and deeper and deeper with God. So let's shine as cleansed vessels, as inquisitive, learner, spirit-driven people who are drawing closer to our light source. Let's shine for His glory like never before. Three main points today. Jesus says, I am the light of the world. He says, I am going away. And He says, I am He. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. All what we talk about doesn't matter unless we actually apply it to our walk. And so if you will, just bow your heads or fold your hands, whatever you do for prayer. You and God, but let's ask these questions. What darkness in our life can we invite Jesus, the light of the world, into to change? Maybe there's just something in our life that we're just not sure about. We just don't feel great about doing it. Let's ask the Lord for truth in that area. Let's ask Him for the light and the truth to walk in His righteousness in that area. Father, we do praise You for Your light, and we pray that You would shine through us, cleanse us, help us with these areas of our life that have darkness. Maybe we realize it, maybe we don't. But we pray that You would illuminate our hearts and lives fully for Your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, the gospel. As we're talking about light, let's talk about the gospel. The gospel is light to a dark world. Sometimes people don't want to hear the gospel because they have been operating in darkness for so long that they have just grown accustomed to darkness. And you come along and you're shining light where their eyes are not accustomed to the light. Their eyes are accustomed to the darkness. And maybe your life, maybe your sincerity, maybe your love, and maybe the gospel coming from your lips or from a gospel tract that you give, maybe that, it does something to them. They don't like that. They don't like that their conscience is pricked by your walk, by your belief, and by the truth that's coming from you in your actions and in your words. And so you have a world that will sometimes react to the gospel. But we don't go with the gospel because God's word says that everybody's going to love it, do we? That's not why we go with the gospel. We go with the gospel because God commanded it and because the people need it and because all of us know that we needed it. All of us know that we were resistant to the gospel probably at some point. And so this gospel that we go forth with and tell people the good news of Jesus, it's a tremendous blessing to them, whether they realize it or not. God knows. That's why God has told you, go with the gospel. So shine on, my friends. Go with the gospel and light up the world. If you have not received Christ, trusted in him for salvation from sin, and been transformed by his indwelling spirit, I encourage you to do that today. Today is the day of salvation. There's nothing more important that you can do in this lifetime than to receive Christ, than to believe on him and trust him. Nothing. And so I invite you to do that right now. And if you have any questions about receiving him, if you have any questions about what we went through in God's word today, or if you have prayer requests about some ailments maybe that you have, or anything, questions about the church, I'll be available in the back, and we'll have a male and female counselor up front. They'll be available for you to pray with you or to answer any questions. We love you, and we want to be here for you. This is not just me speaking at you. This is the body of Christ coming together and worshiping our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's close in prayer. Father, we do thank you for this word about you being the light of the world. Thank you for the illumination that we have in you. Thank you that for centuries, many have been illuminated, and that has been a blessing to us. Thank you. We pray that whatever darkness has come down through our families, whatever sins have been repeated in our families, we pray that they would stop with us, that you would shine light on that, change us, move us to be clean vessels that are near our power source, near our light source, and shining bright for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. May the Lord richly bless you as you follow him. We will conclude with a song.
Let's stand together. God is our light, our hope, our all in all. Blessed be God now and forever. Christ is our home, our life, our joy. As our worship concludes, our service continues.
Amen.